NATO forces on manoeuvres. Only a fraction of the millions of men committed to the defence of Western Europe against the armies of the Warsaw Pact. But the extraordinary fact is that even their own generals lack faith in their capabilities. These armies are expected to be so unsuccessful in the defence of Western Europe by conventional means that they must use a far more deadly threat, a nuclear threat. Nuclear shells, mortars and missiles to be used not against cities and underground silos, but on the battlefields of Europe. As to the reason for this lack of confidence in their conventional forces, both generals and politicians are quite explicit. Warsaw Pact armies outnumber NATO in tanks by 3-1. If any single factor is responsible for the deployment of nuclear weapons in Europe, it is fear of the power of the tank. The question we must ask is, does history justify our fears? How has this technology, now over 70 years old, brought us to such a pass? Ironically, the story begins in the war to end wars. 1915, the Western Front. By now, the battle for Europe had ground to a halt. Advances were measured by the yard, and casualties by the thousand. In a landscape ploughed by shellfire and raked by machine guns, manoeuvre and mobility seemed things of the remote past. There seemed little hope of halting the endless slaughter. The Great War was locked in a bloody stalemate. The cause of the deadlock was new technology. Mass attacks by infantry could never hope to overcome the deadly combination of artillery, machine gun, and barbed wire. As technology had caused the stalemate, it would take new technology to break it. Already there'd been attempts to introduce a new factor into the equation, gas. At first its impact was dramatic, but in the end it was to fail. Poison gas caused almost as many problems for attackers as it did for those attacked. Since the beginning of the war, the problem of towing artillery over a shattered landscape had preoccupied the armies of both sides. But by late 1914, the solution had already been found. It was an American invention, the Holt caterpillar tractor. The performance of the Holt tractor was impressive. One young officer saw that its potential was even greater. He was Lieutenant Colonel Ernest Swinton, a former engineer and now a British Army war correspondent. By July 1915, Swinton was back in England, and there he began work with a small and neglected group, the Admiralty Landships Committee. Swinton had brought with him rough sketches of ideas for a new weapon based on the caterpillar tractor. In a matter of a few months, the combined efforts of Swinton and the committee had produced a prototype, Big Willie. Designed by William Tritton, head of Foster's Engineering, and W.G. Wilson, a well-known automobile engineer, Big Willie used American bullock tracks driven by a 105-horsepower Daimler tractor engine. The center of gravity was kept low by side-mounting the guns. In January 1916, Big Willie had its first trials. The new weapon had also acquired its name. For security reasons, its hull had been described as a water carrier for use in Mesopotamia. Big Willie was a tank. The first tanks had 12 millimeters of frontal armor, weighed over 30 tons, and had a top speed of nearly 4 miles per hour. They came in two versions, one armed with 2 6-pounder naval cannon and 2 machine guns, the other with 6 machine guns. They could cross obstacles 4.5 feet high and trenches 11.5 feet wide. In cramped conditions, nauseated by exhaust fumes, crews suffered temperatures of over 100 degrees Fahrenheit. Although the earliest tanks were British, by 1918, the French had several tank designs. The most successful, the Renault FT light tank, was produced in huge numbers. A major design advance was its turret-mounted gun, which could be rotated through a full 360 degrees. Slowly, tank technology was coming of age. As always, technical developments had raced ahead of military thinking. But by 1918, the generals were at last learning how to use their new weapon. Tanks, instead of being dispersed along a line of infantry, were deployed in concentrated formations for maximum impact. Aircraft were now used to support tank attacks. the new tactics delivered a string of successes. At the Battle of Amiens in August 1918, 7 miles were gained in 9 hours, the kind of success that in 1915 would have seemed miraculous. Against the new weapon and the new tactics, Germany had only old answers. During the entire war, only 20 German tanks were built, and it was already too late. A new technology had changed the face of warfare. What the tank had delivered was not just armor and firepower, but a far more valuable asset, mobility. It was to prove decisive. General von Zweil of the German High Command summed it up. It was not the genius of General Foch that beat us, it was General Tank. The tank had been a latecomer to the war, too late for many British senior officers to be convinced of its impact. By the 1920s, the seeds of warplane technology sown during the Great War were coming to fruition. Britain, preoccupied with the maintenance of a far-flung empire, developed heavy military flying boats. Germany attempted to produce a super-heavy bomber. As the whole world was mesmerized by the power of flight, it was constantly predicted that future wars would be won from the air. For Britain, the combination of financial constraints and the demands of empire ensured that most of the few tanks that were built were light tanks. By 1936, Britain's total tank stock was down to 209 light and 166 medium tanks. Nearly all were obsolete, and nearly all were in the Middle East. But that same year, British tank design was jolted out of its complacency. In 1936, British Army observers made a visit to Russia. They witnessed a startling spectacle: Red Army maneuvers with over 1,000 battle-worthy tanks. The Soviet Union was taking the tank very seriously indeed. The quality of Soviet tanks was astonishing. One series in particular, the medium-weight BTs, had suspension that a British observer could only describe as the work of a genius. It was, but the genius was American. By 1928, J. Walter Christie had designed a tank which could do 70 miles per hour on road wheels and 42 miles per hour on tracks. It was powered by a Liberty V12 engine of 338 horsepower, but its most remarkable feature was a revolutionary suspension system. The American military were not impressed. It was left first to the Soviet Union and later to Britain to buy the Christie patents. By 1933, the Soviet Union was already reaping the benefits, while the British persisted with the designs of the 20s. The 1922 Vickers medium tank was still in production in 1932. It would be 7 more years before British tank technology would benefit from the Christie suspension. While British technology was in limbo, developments in strategy were accelerating. Colonel J.F.C. Fuller, a highly successful World War I tank commander, and Basil Liddell Hart, a soldier turned military correspondent, were arguing for a new strategic doctrine. They believed that the greatest asset of a tank is its mobility. The armored warfare of the future would have no place for slow-moving infantry. Instead, large numbers of tanks would use their speed to surprise the enemy. With local superiority in numbers, they would cut clean through defensive lines. Supported by mechanized infantry and air power, the spearhead force would race for strategic nerve centers. The enemy, prevented from assembling reserves or coordinating a defense, would be thrown into complete confusion. The key to a successful attack would be momentum. But the ideas of the tank men were in the realm of theory. Britain lacked the equipment and the military establishment the inclination to make it reality. But there was one place where the new strategic doctrine was eagerly embraced. Since the Treaty of Versailles, Germany had been restricted to a standing army of 100,000 men. Traditional military doctrines were useless, but since 1926, the army had been testing tanks. Designed and built by Krupp, the Mark I was intended as a training tank. It weighed 6 tons, had 13 millimeters of front armor and 2 machine guns. Its top speed was 25 miles per hour. The 9-ton Mark II was designed by MAN. By 1937, it had a hefty 30 millimeters of front armor, a 20 millimeter main gun, and a machine gun. But Germany had more than just tanks. It had an ardent admirer of the theories of Fuller and Little Hart. General Heinz Guderian was to become a master tank strategist. By 1937, Guderian had formed a panzer corps of one panzer division with Mark I's and Mark II's, and a full division of mechanized infantry. Before long, he would take the idea of integrated mechanized forces to its logical conclusion, the Panzer Army. Tanks, aircraft, mechanized infantry, artillery, and anti-tank support, all under a single commander. The Panzer Army was a completely self-contained strike force. It could seize opportunities and follow them through. The signs were ominous. As Germany prepared for mobility, France built the Maginot Line. Embankments, anti-tank guns, and minefields would surely repulse any German adventure. This time, France would be prepared. Not all of France's faith was placed in the Maginot Line. In tanks, the pace of French technology was astonishing. In 1919, they already had the heavy Char C. By 1936, France had the Hotchkiss cavalry tank. The 10-ton Hotchkiss had a top speed of 17 miles per hour, a full 40 millimeters of armor, and a 37 millimeter gun. It was produced in huge quantities. The Saumur was also a 10-ton machine with 40 millimeters of armor, a 47 millimeter gun, and capable of 25 miles per hour. But the new Char B1 was a monster. 30 tons, 60 millimeters of armor, and both 75 and 47 millimeter guns. In 1937, when the Char B1 had been in production for over 2 years, Britain was producing the 11-ton Matilda 1 as a matter of priority. It was armed with a single machine gun and had a top speed of 8 miles per hour. By now, Germany's panzers had already been to war in Spain. With the annexation of Czechoslovakia in March 1939, events in Europe were gathering momentum. Britain, alarmed at the state of its mechanized forces, had stepped up tank development. There was a new British tank, the 26-ton Matilda II. It had 78 millimeters of armor and an effective 40 millimeter gun, but its top speed was only 15 miles per hour. It had been designed only to support infantry. A fast British tank was being built, the medium cruiser Mark III. At last, the American Christie suspension had been fitted to a British tank. The cruiser was well armed, with a 40 millimeter gun and had a top speed of 30 miles per hour. Its performance on maneuvers was impressive, but on the battlefield, it would prove disastrously unreliable. In any case, the new British tanks were too few and too late. September 1st, 1939. 3,195 German tanks in 6 panzer and 4 light divisions mass on the Polish border. The theories of Fuller and Little Hart take on a grim reality, Blitzkrieg. As aircraft and artillery disrupted reinforcements and paralyzed vital centers, the panzers smashed through Polish defenses. Mechanized infantry raced to exploit the breakthroughs. Poland, completely unprepared for the new warfare, could offer little resistance. In Hitler's grand design, Poland had been phase one. Phase two was in the west. Britain and France declared war on Germany. For 8 months, it was the phony war. The Germans fought from behind their Siegfried line and the French from the Maginot line. It amounted a little more than sporadic artillery duels, but behind the gestures, Hitler was gathering his panzers. In October 1939, the British Expeditionary Force was dispatched to France. It had only 229 tanks. All but 58 were light tanks. The Vickers Mark VI weighed under 5 tons. In service since 1936, it had only 15 millimeters of armor and 2 machine guns. As the British took up positions to the north, the French deployed to the northeast. They were secure in the belief that the Maginot Line would defend their flank. With superb medium and heavy tanks, the French armed forces were believed to be invincible. The belief was about to be proved an illusion. May 1940, the Forest of the Ardennes. Lying between most of the French armies and the Maginot Line, the Ardennes was believed impossible terrain for tanks. But the panzers had been practicing for months. Again, it was blitzkrieg. Supply lines were cut and reinforcements destroyed. Opposing the German advance were 2 French armies of poorly equipped and badly trained reservists. Against seasoned veterans of the Polish campaign, they had little chance. French tanks, the few that there were in this sector of the front, were spread out in support of the infantry. Against mass armor, with full artillery support, they were useless. By breaking through the Ardennes, the panzers had bypassed the Maginot Line. Within 5 days, they had crossed the River Meuse. In 5 days more, they would reach the English Channel. For Germany, blitzkrieg in the west had none of the certainty of the Polish campaign. In armor, they were outnumbered by almost 2 to 1. Even the latest panzer, the Mark III with its 37mm gun, was inferior to the medium and heavy Allied tanks. But it was not tanks which had lost France, it was the generals. The battle for France was less a clash of armies than of ideas, ideas of how a mechanized war should be fought. In the end, all that remained was to save as many as could be saved. At Dunkirk, Britain was forced to abandon nearly all of its armoured strength. There was a frantic rush to replace the lost tanks. But the cruisers, even with their Christie suspension, and the Matildas with their heavy armour, were fast becoming obsolete. The panzer designers had learned from their experience in France. They were already moving towards 50 and 75mm high-velocity guns. But the British couldn't increase their gun size beyond 40mm. Bigger guns would need bigger turrets, and bigger turrets couldn't be fitted to existing British tank designs. In North Africa, for hundreds of British tank crews, the consequences would be disastrous. As British tank designs were locked into the past, so was British strategy. German success in France had been built on fast-moving, concentrated armour. Most of the British general staff had failed to grasp that lesson. There was, however, one notable exception. In December 1940, Major General R.D. O'Connor was sent to counter an Italian invasion of North Africa. O'Connor was unique among British generals. He fully understood the new art of mechanized warfare. What is more, the forces under his command understood it too. Back in 1938, they had been trained by a notable exponent of the tank. Major General P.C.S. Hobart was passionately committed to a fully mechanized strategy. For his unorthodox views, he was removed from command in 1939. Between December 1940 and February 1941, O'Connor delivered a string of victories over the Italians. His first blow fell at Sidi Barrani, Tanks, mechanized infantry, aircraft, and naval power were brilliantly coordinated. Victory at Sidi Barani was followed up without hesitation. In a bold drive along the coast, using naval gunfire to support his land forces, O'Connor took one stronghold after another. In quick succession, Sidi Barani was followed by Tobruk, Derna, and Beira Fomm. O'Connor was now poised to capture the few remaining Italian strongholds before Tripoli. O'Connor was never given the chance to pursue a final victory. In February 1941, he was ordered to halt. The bulk of his forces were to be withdrawn and sent to the Balkans. O'Connor's bold use of tanks had earned the Matilda the title Queen of the Desert, but the reign of the Matilda was almost over. On February 12, 1941, Rommel landed at Tripoli. He brought with him his Africa Corps and the technical flair that was to make him a legend. At once, Rommel went on the offensive. Within weeks, the British 2nd Armoured Brigade had been destroyed. Soon he had encircled Tobruk. The key was the manoeuvre and coordination of tanks and artillery. With General O'Connor captured, British tactical thinking was bankrupt. Numerically superior, British armour was constantly deployed in small groups. Rommel, by concentrating his panzers, destroyed them group by group. To add to British difficulties, their 40mm tank gun was wholly inadequate. Its range was inferior, and it could only fire armor-piercing shells. Against artillery, they were useless. That the British were not defeated by Rommel's Africa Corps was simply an accident of history. Rommel was never given the resources to do the job. Hitler's eyes had already turned to the east. June 1941, Operation Barbarossa. 19 panzer divisions, 3,196 tanks, streamed over Soviet frontiers in three great surges. Hitler's long-cherished plan for the conquest of Russia was finally underway. It was the beginning of the greatest land war in history. While artillery and aircraft struck at tank parks, supply depots, and airfields, the panzers drove all before them. It was a classical blitzkrieg. Soviet tank forces had a huge advantage in numbers, but neither their numbers nor their quality would make the slightest difference. In the early 1930s, Stalin had twice purged the ranks of Red Army officers. An entire generation of experienced commanders had been lost. The result was an army of stifled initiative and widespread inefficiency. As the panzer divisions raced into the heartland of Russia, only a fraction of Soviet tanks were in working order. The Red Air Force, suffering from the same inertia as the army, was caught on the ground. Of the Soviet tanks that survived the initial onslaught, few were handled with skill. Like the French in 1939, they were deployed only in support of infantry. The panzers seemed invincible. For the German generals, the key to success was momentum. The immediate objective was Moscow. According to Hitler, at the first blow, the Soviet Union would collapse like a pack of cards. But in spite of the continuing tactical successes, all was not according to plan. At the first shock of blitzkrieg, the Soviet Union and Stalin himself had been stunned. Bereft of leadership, the Red Army was on the verge of collapse. Stalin finally took decisive action. What Russia needed above all was time. What it had was space and men. Stalin ordered that both should be sacrificed. At all costs, the Red Army was to avoid decisive battles. Instead, isolated units would fight delaying actions, if necessary, to the last man. The first 3 weeks of Barbarossa saw a string of German tactical successes. By July 9th, the armored pincer of Army Group Center under von Bock had captured the city of Minsk. By the 15th, they had taken Smolensk. Panzer Group North, under General von Leib, was driving towards Leningrad. To the south, von Rundstedt struck at Kiev, but already it was taking too much precious time. Red Army resistance was soaking up German momentum. Pockets of men and armor, hopelessly cut off, stubbornly refused to surrender. As the panzers advanced, their vital supply lines stretched dangerously. Already, partisans were a serious threat, a factor that had never entered the Blitzkrieg equation. Behind the decreasing momentum of what was intended to be a lightning war was a fundamental flaw in German preparations. Back in 1918, the British strategist Fuller had already realized that all vehicles in an armored attack had to be tracked vehicles. But the Wehrmacht's supply columns depended on trucks. As the panzers waited for supplies to catch up, lost opportunities multiplied. While the drive to Moscow slowed, Hitler's worries increased. The German war machine would need oil in vast quantities, and there were oil fields in the Caucasus. Hitler ordered the bulk of the panzers to swing south. On the threshold of the Soviet capital, the remaining armies waited. On September 26th, Hitler resumed the drive for Moscow. By now, the defense of the Soviet capital had been handed over to a little-known general, Georgi Zhukov. Zhukov had learned the art of tank warfare in the Russo-Japanese War. He had also devised an elegant solution to the problem of infantry transport. He had carried troops on the backs of his tanks. South of Moscow was the entire 2nd Panzer Army. Zhukov had only one independent tank force, the 4th Armored Brigade. But what the Soviets lacked in numbers of tanks, they made up for in quality. Now, standing between the panzers and the gates of Moscow was a masterpiece of tank design, the T-34. Developed from the BT series, it was the perfect compromise between firepower and armor, speed, operating range, and reliability. Yet it was so simple, it could be repaired at frontline workshops. In spite of the T-34's 28-ton weight, its ground-bearing pressure on 19-inch tracks was only 10 pounds per square inch. Its ability to cross soft ground was unequaled. Heavily armed with a 76mm gun and two machine guns, the T-34 carried up to 60mm of frontal armor. In spite of its weight, the T-34 was an extremely fast tank. A 500-horsepower diesel engine gave it a top speed of 31 miles per hour. Its shape was revolutionary too. For deflecting shells, it had sloped armor. On the evening of October 11th, the Mark III's and Mark IVs of the 4th Panzer Division were strung out along a narrow road just outside Moscow. Zhukov unleashed his T-34s. On their broad tracks, they raced cross-country. The assault sliced clean through the German flank. 4th Panzer was virtually destroyed. The effect of the T-34 on German morale was devastating. One panzer crewman described them. The Russian tanks are so agile. At close range, they will climb a slope or cross a piece of swamp faster than you can traverse the turret. Their sloped armor plate was doing its work too. The armor-piercing shells of Mark III's and Mark IVs were simply bouncing off them. The technical superiority of the panzers was over. From the onset of winter, the panzers had faced new problems. Freezing temperatures forced crews to run their engines for 15 minutes every 4 hours. It was impossible to keep their position secret. The increased fuel consumption was a heavy burden when maintaining supplies was already a nightmare. While the Eastern Front was locked in winter, the war in North Africa was again gaining momentum. In January 1942, Rommel went on the offensive. The key to success for his drive into Cyrenaica was to be complete surprise. Not even the German High Command were informed of his plans. Rommel acted quickly. On January 21st, he launched his offensive. Facing Rommel were understrength British tank forces with inexperienced crews. The panzers drove clean through the British columns. 15th Panzer advanced 50 miles in under 4 hours, destroying column after column. The British commander, General Ritchie, refused to believe that Rommel was engaged in a major offensive. He was disastrously wrong. By the end of January, Benghazi had fallen and the British had withdrawn to defensive positions on the Gazala line. In the face of Rommel's decisiveness and speed, the British had no coherent strategy. Their tank forces, initially superior to Rommel's, were destroyed piecemeal, achieving nothing. By June 20th, the Gazala line had been abandoned and Tobruk had fallen. The British withdrew yet again, this time to El Alamein, the vital gateway to Egypt. Nothing short of radical changes could restore the fortunes of the demoralized 8th Army. Above all, it needed a new commander. On August 12th, Montgomery arrived in Cairo. Without delay, he set about bolstering El Alamein's inadequate defenses. Rommel was about to strike at Alam Halfa. In the defense, Montgomery's main weapon would not be the mobility of the tank, but the striking power of artillery and aircraft. During the 4 days of Rommel's offensive, RAF and American aircraft flew over 2,500 missions. The panzer's vulnerability to air attack was graphically demonstrated. On September 3rd, Rommel ordered his forces onto the defensive. At the Battle of Alam Halfa, tanks were not the decisive factor. Allied aircraft and artillery strikes had so disrupted Rommel's supply lines and assembly positions that success for the panzers was a vain hope. For the British, Alam Halfa was not a major victory. Each side lost comparable numbers of men and tanks, but its effect on 8th Army morale would have far-reaching consequences. For the Africa Corps, it was already the beginning of the end. October 24th, 1942, the Battle of El Alamein. For more than 6 weeks, Montgomery had waited. His objective was total material superiority. The Axis powers' failure to take Malta had allowed the landing of huge quantities of American materials. While the British had a 2-to-1 advantage in men, tanks, and artillery, Rommel had fuel for only 11 days. El Alamein was to be a battle not of tactics, but of materials. Within 3 days, British artillery and airstrikes had taken a heavy toll of the panzers and their supply lines. But Rommel's hands were tied. With insufficient fuel for a fighting withdrawal, his only option was a vigorous defense. With panzer losses mounting, Rommel switched the emphasis of the defense to his 88mm anti-tank guns. Against the high-sided American Grant tanks, they were very successful, but unlike Rommel, the British could afford their losses. After 12 days of battle and heavy air attacks, Rommel had lost over half his men and was left with only 20 tanks. With Rommel's retreat, the tide in North Africa had turned decisively. The Eastern Front, December 1941. As the panzer offensive ground to a halt less than 20 miles from Moscow, General Zhukov launched his Siberian divisions into a frantic counter-offensive. On December 5th, Hitler ordered his infantry to hold while the battered panzers were withdrawn and refitted. But the order was impossible to carry out. As the Soviet offensive gained momentum, retreat turned to chaos. It was weeks before the German front was stabilized. Again, the panzers were ordered onto the offensive. This time, the objectives were the Volga and Stalingrad. For German tank crews, Stalingrad was to prove a death trap. Mobility was out of the question. Terms were dictated not by the panzers, but by the Russian infantry. While the defenders offered fierce resistance, German forces in the city were being completely encircled. On February 2nd, 1943, the entire 6th Army, under Field Marshal von Paulus, surrendered to Zhukov. 20 German divisions had been annihilated and 1,500 tanks lost. It was Germany's greatest defeat of the war, and a blow from which the morale of the elite armored formations would never recover. Everywhere there were Soviet victories, there was the T-34 tank. So great had been the impact of the T-34 at Moscow that German tank designers had visited the front at once. Their purpose was to study the T-34 at first hand. Somehow, Germany had to match it. In the event, much time was wasted. It was May 1943 before German industry's challenge to the T-34 rolled off the production lines. The new tank was the Panther. Like the T-34, the Panther had sloped armor, a 75mm high-velocity gun, and two machine guns. It had 80mm of frontal armor. In July 1943, only 2 months after the prototype was built, Panthers and T-34s were to clash in the greatest tank battle ever seen, the Battle of Kursk. At the Kursk salient, Hitler intended that the Soviets would suffer a crushing blow. The planned offensive was named Operation Citadel. Operation Citadel was devised by Army Chief of Staff General Zeitler. His faith in the Panthers was unshakable, and what is more, Germany had a new heavy tank, the Tiger. At 55 tons, the Henschel Tiger was the world's heaviest tank. Armed with an 88mm gun and protected by armor up to 100mm thick, it was a formidable weapon. A 700 horsepower petrol engine gave it a top speed of 23.5 miles per hour. A new heavy self-propelled gun based on the Tiger had also reached the front. Its fixed 88mm gun gave it formidable firepower. The Red Army too had been preparing. Zhukov's strategy was first to wear down the panzers, then launch a counteroffensive of such force that the Wehrmacht would never recover. The first task of the defenders at Kursk would be to deprive the panzers of their major asset, mobility. The salient was to be transformed into one vast fortress. Civilians dug over 3,000 miles of trenches and ditches. 2,200 anti-tank mines and 148 guns were placed on every mile of front. In some sectors, the defensive line was 100 miles deep. The Soviet war machine was in full swing. To counter the threat of the Tiger, T-34s were upgunned to 85mm. Manufacturing methods were improved too. The turret of the T-34 was being stamped rather than cast, greatly speeding production. Giant factories in the east produced that year 3,500 light tanks and 16,000 medium and heavy tanks. On the German side, panzer forces from all over the Eastern Front were poured into the Kursk salient, a total of 2,500 tanks. But the sheer scale of Soviet preparations shook at least some of the German high command. General Guderian was particularly worried about the new Panthers. They were beset with teething troubles. Even Hitler admitted, "Whenever I think of this attack, my stomach turns over." July 4th, dawn breaks on the day that is to witness the greatest tank battle in history. Red Army intelligence already knew the exact time of the planned attack. While the panzers stood in their start positions, the Soviet gunners waited. 10 minutes before the German attack, they unleashed a barrage of 600 guns and mortars. The Battle of Kursk had begun. 0500, Hoth's 4th Panzer Army was unleashed from the south. The formation chosen was the Panzerkeil, an armoured wedge, motorised infantry at the base, Panthers and Mark IVs on the flanks, and a spearhead of heavy Ferdinands and Tigers. The Panthers especially suffered heavy losses. Committed to a major battle without adequate testing, mechanical problems brought many to a grinding halt. In the arc of fire that was Kursk, a breakdown meant certain destruction for the tank and for the infantry it was meant to support. The contrast between the complexity of the Panther and the rugged simplicity of Soviet T-34s could not have been greater. The radio operator of a Tiger described the attack. As we advanced, the Russian artillery ploughed the earth around us. The whole front was a girdle of flashes. It seemed as if we were driving into a ring of flame. 4 times our valiant Tiger shuddered under a direct hit. To the north, Model's 9th Army was launching its attack. At 0530, one panzer and 9 infantry divisions stormed a 25-mile sector of the central front. They met a wall of high explosives and armor-piercing shells. Death came from the air, too. At Kursk, anti-tank aircraft came into their own. Stukas armed with cannon were a highly successful innovation. A famous Stuka pilot, Hans Rudel, wrote, "In the first attack, 4 tanks explode under the hammer blows of my cannon. By the evening, the total rises to 12. The evil spell is broken, and in this aircraft we possess a weapon which can be speedily employed everywhere and is capable of dealing successfully with the formidable numbers of Soviet tanks." But Rudel's optimism was premature. Hoth's panzer wedge was crumbling. Soviet artillery, aircraft, and infantry were peeling the vulnerable Mark IVs and Panthers from the wedge. As the Panzers penetrated deeper into Soviet defenses, only the heavily armored Tigers and Ferdinands remained. There they faced new artillery tactics, the pack front. Fire centers of Soviet guns, each defended by its own infantry, concentrated a hail of fire in strict coordination. One Soviet battery alone destroyed 15 tanks before it too was destroyed. Soviet defenses were soaking up the might of the Panzers. What is more, Red Army reserves seemed inexhaustible. Only when the attack had been blunted by fixed defenses did Zhukov unleash his tanks. By July 10th, the German offensive had stalled, crippled by endless minefields and withering fire. In 9 days, only 20 miles had been gained, while casualties were of First World War proportions. Now, nothing short of a major breakthrough could save Operation Citadel. July 13th. From his depleted forces, General Hoth launched a force of 600 tanks in a race for the strategically vital town of Prokhorovka. To the north, the surviving heavy panzers were trapped in the Soviet infantry zone. One by one, the Ferdinands were picked off by anti-tank squads. Their designer, Porsche, had neglected to equip them with machine guns. Already, the Battle of Kursk was becoming a battle of resources. As the stakes rose, Zhukov threw in his reserves. As the ground battle intensified, the struggle for the skies grew steadily more ferocious. As with tanks, the battle was one of attrition. The side which could replace its losses would gain the ascendancy. The Soviets were winning the race. Hoth's panzers thrust for the town of Prokhorovka ended in head-on collision. It was a Soviet 5th Guards army, a force of 900 tanks. At Prokhorovka, it was tank against tank at ranges down to 100 yards. The ground battle would rage for 8 hours. To tank men, the attack was to become legendary. They called it the Death Ride. Guderian describes the scene. "Never have I received such an overwhelming impression of Russian strength and numbers as on that day. The clouds of dust made it difficult to get help from the Luftwaffe, and soon many of the T-34s had broken past our screen and were streaming like rats all over the battlefield. In that single battle, Germany had lost 400 tanks and 10,000 men. It was a disaster. By early August, the Battle of Kursk was over. The panzer armies had been smashed. They had lost 50,000 men, 800 guns, 1,200 aircraft, and 2,500 tanks. Nothing that German industry could do could ever make up for losses on such a scale. At the Battle of Kursk, Germany had thrown its tanks against an enemy who had chosen and fortified his own ground. General Guderian once said that the engine of a tank is as important a weapon as its gun. At Kursk, all that had been forgotten. Mobility, speed, and surprise had simply been thrown away. With this last great gamble, Hitler's intention had been to open the road to Moscow. In the event, the road opened was the road to Berlin. D-Day, June 6, 1944. The huge armada assembled for the invasion of France was at its most exposed. But the Luftwaffe was nowhere to be seen. The remnants were fighting desperate defensive actions in the east, or defending the fatherland itself from ceaseless air raids. Only 319 German aircraft were available in the west. The Allies had over 13,000. On the beaches, Allied men and armor met fierce resistance, but it came from German infantry and artillery. Not only were the Luftwaffe missing from the German defense, so were the panzers. Hitler, convinced that the real landings were to take place near Calais, refused to commit his armor. The defenders, without tank support, faced a tide of specialized armor. The Churchill Crocodile mounted a flamethrower with a range of 80 yards as well as its 75mm gun. Tanks with flailing chains cleared minefields. There were tanks for every conceivable purpose. The Germans themselves deployed a specialized tank remotely controlled by cable. In Hitler's secret weapons program, it was codenamed Goliath. But it would take more than a handful of secret weapons to contain the growing flood of Allied war materials. As in North Africa, the strategy was to crush German defenses with sheer material superiority. With the beachhead secure, the task for the Allies was to break out of the pocket they'd created. The wooded terrain of the Bocage strongly favored the defenders, but still there were no panzers. In reserve, Hitler had three elite panzer divisions, Rommel's 21st, the 12th SS Hitlerjugend, and the Panzerlehr division. But everywhere, German infantry faced Allied armor with only a handful of supporting tanks. The British Churchill was originally designed in 1939 to fight battles of a First World War type. With up to 150mm of armor, it was extremely well protected, but with a weight of 40 tons, its top speed was only 15 miles per hour. Nevertheless, it was to prove a stable and well-armored platform for special devices, from chain flails to flamethrowers. The 28-ton Cromwell was a descendant of the cruiser. It was by now the most important British tank. The Cromwell was very fast. Its 600 horsepower Rolls-Royce Meteor engine gave it a top speed of 40 miles per hour. It was well armed with a British 75mm gun. But the mainstay of Allied armor in Normandy was the American Sherman. The Sherman weighed 33 tons and had up to 50mm of cast armor. It had new, long-life rubber-jointed tracks and a top speed of 25 miles per hour. It was so well suited to mass production that one could be built in 30 minutes. The Sherman was armed with an American 75mm or a British 17-pounder gun, hydroelectrically stabilized so that it could aim and fire while on the move. Finally, the decision had been taken to deploy the panzers, but it was too late. Allied monopoly of the air would mean they could travel only by night. To be caught in the open in daylight meant certain destruction. Artillery and air bombardment made roads impassable and reduced vital junctions to rubble. German communications were in complete chaos. Not only had the panzers been committed too late, Guderian's principle of concentrated armor was being ignored. The panzers were deployed in small formations. The result was steady attrition. On July 9th, the British had penetrated the southern suburbs of the city of Caen. It had already taken over a month to cover the 8 miles scheduled by Montgomery for the first day of the invasion. But Cherbourg had fallen to the Americans. On July 11th, the 2nd SS Panzer Division and the Panzerlehr Division attempted to cut off American forces at Saint-Lô. But Panzerlehr was down to one-third of its tank strength and faced 3 American divisions. Then the weather cleared. In one sector alone, out of 32 German tanks, 20 were destroyed from the air. The tank was showing itself not as the feared weapon of mobility it had seemed in the days of Blitzkrieg and in the hands of Guderian and Rommel. It was half a weapon. The other half was in the skies. Without air cover, tanks were helpless. By October 1944, the Allies had a 500-mile front packed with 70 divisions. Panzerlehr had been annihilated by massed air attacks. Patton had struck south through the gap and into the wide spaces of central France. By the end of December, Hitler's last gamble had failed. At the Battle of the Bulge, the last concentrations of armor that Germany could muster had been smashed by 5,000 Allied aircraft. Germany had fought its last major tank battle of World War II. Germany's victories had been a direct result of strategic and tactical genius. The possibilities of a new weapon had been understood and used against forces which failed to understand. But while its enemies learned the art of tank warfare, German armies, with Hitler in personal command, forgot. In the streets of Stalingrad and at the Kursk salient, Hitler had thrown away the tank's greatest assets, mobility and surprise. While in North Africa and in Normandy, the Allies skillfully exploited the power of the fighter-bomber. In a sense, the Second World War was a disastrous experiment in the possibilities of the tank. The result was a divided Europe. Berlin itself is now a symbol of the tension between the great power blocks. As NATO and Warsaw Pact tanks face each other on the frontiers of East and West, memories of Blitzkrieg haunt generals and politicians. The question we must ask is, could Blitzkrieg succeed again in Europe? It seems unlikely. The effectiveness of the tank depends on surprise and air superiority. In the age of the spy satellite, surprise is virtually unattainable. From the air, anti-tank helicopters pose a new threat. So-called smart weapons can destroy tanks and their air cover. The combination of helicopter gunships and airborne infantry may be far more effective than the tank in achieving mobility on the battlefield. In Europe, its birthplace, the tank is very much an actor in search of a role. But one thing is certain, the tank's ability to induce fear in generals and politicians alike is as potent as at any time in its long and bloodstained history.